Revelation 12:11. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death. Welcome to By the Word of Their Testimony, and here is your host, Etienne McClintock.
Dear listener, greetings and a warm welcome. Thank you for tuning into the program today. I'm delighted to have your company. And with me in the studio, I have a special guest all the way from Papua New Guinea. Leeboy Tobias, welcome to the program.
Thank you very much.
It's lovely to have you here. Now, I know you have a fascinating tale to tell, a story of how the Lord has impacted your life and changed your life. But before we start that, perhaps you can just tell us a little bit about what you currently do.
Currently, I am one of the church pastor at Central Papua Conference in Papua New Guinea.
Okay.
And I am pastoring one of the rural church in, it's about approximately 4 hours drive away from Port Moresby, which is called the Dubanatebo Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Right. Yeah. Okay. And how long have you been the pastor there?
I think it's about approximately it's 4 or 5 months now.
5 months. Yeah. Okay. So it's quite a new appointment.
Absolutely. It is.
Okay. Wonderful. Now, I take it that as far as that occupation is concerned, that's something new. Is there anybody else in your family that's a pastor?
Absolutely. Actually, I am the only Seventh-day Adventist in our family, and just currently my mother joined me. So
your mum has just joined you?
Absolutely.
Oh, praise the Lord for that. That's good to hear. Now, let's maybe step back from there. Tell us where you were born, you know, family influences, siblings, parents, and so on.
I was born up in the highlands of Papua New Guinea, which is called the Eastern Islands Province, in a small district called the Daulo District in Asaro. And this is where my mom and my father come from. So that is where I was born from, yeah.
Right, okay. And your parents, were they from big families?
Yep. My parents were from a big family, but, you know, it's my mother is from another village and my father was from another village, so.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what's life like typically in the highlands there, in the villages?
Right now it's a bit okay, but, you know, it's the same. Like most of the things that happened in the past is still, like, take, for example, tribal fight and land dispute. And
okay.
Yeah, it's continuously, like, here and there, people are fighting.
Mm.
Yeah, so.
So is it tribal? Is it sometimes between one town and another town that the fighting takes place? Or can it be sometimes within the town itself?
It's always, like, mostly it happens from, like, another town and another town, like, fighting against each other. Mm. Sometimes it's between the villages only and, you know, different lifestyle out there where, you
okay.
know, yeah, they fight against each other.
And how do people live? How do they survive? Where do they get their food from?
Up in the islands, it's when you talk about food, they are rich.
Okay.
They have, you know, garden and all this farming and all this one, so all the crops and everything, it's just there.
So they do a lot of planting themselves and agricultural farming. And yeah,
agricultural farming. And
is there a lot of natural fruit available as well, or is there something that you have to cultivate?
It's like most of those natural fruit are natural.
Okay.
Yeah, it's just grow up in the islands where it's everything is
so
just
if you're hungry, you can find food somewhere around
absolutely.
There.
Absolutely. Just go in the bush and you find anything.
Okay. Right. And this was the environment that you grew up in?
Absolutely. Hmm.
Now, how many children were you in your family?
We were three in the family, my father, my brother, and my sister was the firstborn, and then my brother, bigger brother, and then myself.
So you're the youngest in the family?
Absolutely. I am the youngest in the family.
Oh, okay. Oh, very good. So you grew up in this family. Your family also had some farmland that they cultivated so you could, you know, have your food and all that?
As far as I know, like when I grew up, we don't have those land.
Okay.
Because that's where we were. We were already in Port Moresby. When I was,
Okay, so you were born there, but you moved to Port Moresby at a young
absolutely.
Age. Do you know how old you were roughly when you left with your family to go and live in Port Moresby?
Probably around 6 months or 7-8 months.
Oh, very young. Yeah. So you grew up in Port Moresby.
Absolutely.
Port Moresby is your hood. That's your town.
That's my town. Okay. Sometimes people said, well, you're not from the islands. You're from the Port Moresby.
Ah, yeah. Okay. Right, understand. So when you were growing up in Port Moresby, what were your family doing? What were they involved in?
My family, we were traveling, like we were shifting from one place to another.
Okay.
Yeah, because
so quite
of that.
Transient.
We were transiting from one place to the because we don't have any like land to settle, permanent residence. So we have to just travel from one place to another, and then finally we just we traveled to Baronir garbage dump where we just live near. It's about approximately 3 kilometers away, 4 kilometers. Yeah.
From the rubbish dump?
From the rubbish dump in Port Moresby.
Okay. Yeah. So how old were you around at this time when you guys lived there? Was this still around the age of six?
I think it's about 7 years old. Yeah. Okay. Around 7 and 6 years old when we lived at the garbage dump. Yeah, rubbish.
Right. Okay. Now, for people, obviously, live in Australia, New Zealand, other places, because we broadcast to Papua New Guinea as well, but for people living in Australia, New Zealand, what is it that makes people live close to the rubbish dump? What is the attraction there? Because typically people want to live away from a rubbish dump, yeah?
I don't know what to say, but, for us, we want to live at the rubbish dump, and people away around Australia and New Zealand might want to live away from the rubbish.
Yes.
Yeah, so...
So at the rubbish dump, is it because of there's resources there? You can find food there, or you can find articles or materials to build? Or what is it that's attractive for people to live close to the rubbish dump?
Those people who live at the garbage dump, it takes a lot of years for them. And like in the rubbish dump, in the garbage dump, there are many things that we find. Like help us sustain, make ends meet, and we recycle some of the tin cans.
Okay.
Even the bottles and anything that we can find from the garbage dump.
Right.
Yeah. Even the food, too. We always receive our food from the garbage dump, our daily needs from the garbage dump.
Is that right?
Absolutely.
Okay. So there's food that gets dropped out there?
Yeah, by different vehicles that travel in and out from the garbage dump trucks.
Okay. And when you say recycling, you're using those materials to build things, or can you actually trade them and get some money for them?
Thank you very much for asking me this question, and I'll be very happy to answer them. There are food that we receive from the garbage dump, which, we eat directly a lot. But we know exactly different type of food, which is brought in by different vehicle on a certain amount of time, like that.
Okay.
Certain time. And we know exactly where the driver bring those food from. So everything, even I can just sit like about 2 or 3 kilometers away, and by the sound of the engine of the vehicle, I know which vehicle
and who it's driving and where it's from.
Absolutely, that's so.
Wow,
different vehicles bring different things into the garbage dump. So we get those tin or maybe a copper and aluminium or the bottle. Or we collect them and then we have to bring it to the recycling plant.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then we get some money.
Even sometimes we get some of the food, like expired food or something like that. Sometimes it's kind of funny that we have to bring it to the city in the Port Moresby and resell those things.
Oh, you can resell them?
We can resell them.
So the food is actually not always bad quality. It's not something that someone's just, maybe they just had access and then they got rid of it.
Absolutely. Like sometimes, the deep fridge in some of the certain stores. So like the deep fridge just shut down, the generator shut down, and they don't have anywhere to store those. So they have to dump all the food and all these things at the dump site. So we have to just get it from the garbage dump, resell it again on the streets.
Well, that's an interesting little economy set up there, isn't it?
Absolutely. And it's
But that's how people survive, and that's how they can get money.
Dump has become the source for the people living over there. So, for generations to generations, people are living at the dump site.
But it sounds like there's a bit of industry going on there as well. So people who are at the dump site, and want to live, they can't just sit there and do nothing. They've got to be active to earn money if they want to, and then also sell food and sell aluminium cans and everything else.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, well, that's quite a different picture to what we typically would have. We'd sometimes think, well, people just go to the dump site, and if something comes, they'll just grab it, and then they'll eat it.
No.
It's nothing like that.
We know exactly, we always see different people maybe some of the Australian or other countries, they just travel in, and even some of the Papua New Guineans, which they don't live at the gum side, but while just traveling, they thought that we eat all those garbage and it's smelly and all this, but we are not that, you know, we know we are
it's
human
beings. It's more sophisticated than that, isn't
Absolutely.
It?
We are human beings. We know exactly what's happening over there.
Yeah, yeah.
So just because they are not into, like, they cannot, it's hardly for them to get into our shoes and just to understand our situation.
Mm.
They have to just turn over there and comment a lot without realizing what is happening, actually happening there.
Yeah.
Downside, so.
Wow. Okay. Well, there's some entrepreneurs at the rubbish dump, no doubt. Yeah.
Absolutely.
So when you're about 7 years old, you guys moved closer to the rubbish dump. And I can understand why now, because it's a place of resources.
Absolutely.
And also a means of generating income for the family. You're about 3 kilometers away. Do you end up living at the rubbish dump at any stage? Or you always live about, you know, a little bit of a distance away from it?
We live just a little bit of distance away from the garbage dump, but we always travel to the dump site to, you know, find anything that we can find, recycle and make ends meet during the day. So garbage has also become our, you know, it's not for the people living in the dump, but it's just beside the dump also.
Okay.
Yeah, me and my family, we travel every now and then to the dump site.
Okay, and to, and to work into...
Even right now, currently, while we are speaking, my mother is at the dump site.
Oh, is that right?
Absolutely. It's, okay. She's still there.
That is incredible. So... Would you say how many people would live from that dump site, the one that you're talking about?
Approximately, like in the past back then, like it's more than 350, not people, but families.
350 families.
Families, more than 350 families.
Mm.
But currently they have a project, a recycling plant just set up right at the dump site. So, you know, people are moving, gradually they are moving slowly away from the dump site. So now might be about more than 150 families living at that current.
Still there.
Yeah, still there at that dump site.
So what's causing people to start moving away from it? Why aren't so many people dependent on the dump site, immediate dump site like they used to be in the past? Has anything changed?
At the dump site, currently the government of Papua New Guinea establishing a plant site, a recycling plant site where those people living at the dump site, it's hard for them because the plant site is, you know, it's trying to take up some of the space and it burns all the rubbish, the garbage that come into it. So people cannot get those things that they need, the wants and the needs from that garbage dump. So they are gradually moving away from the dump site now.
Okay, looking for alternatives to,
absolutely.
To live and survive.
Yeah,
Okay. So can you tell us, what was it like growing up in that environment for you?
Wow, it would be a blessing and a pleasure for me to talk about what we did, like how it looks like growing in the dump site. Like we don't have power.
No power.
Yeah, no power. Not even like we don't have any like access to water. So like we have to just try our best to, you know, live at the garbage dump. And like every now and then people like the boys, we always break the pipe that travels the water pipe. We have to break it and then the PNG water board or the head around, they always come and fix it up, and the government always come and fix it up. We break it again, they fixed it up, we break it again. So,
but that's so you can access the water.
Access the
drink.
Water.
Yeah.
So they were tired of us, so they put a water tap up. So now people have access to the water, but power we have nothing. So
okay.
Every now and then we have to just walk some kilometers to school and back, and then to help ourselves at the dump site. So it's kind of, I mean, for us it's just. It's very tough out there.
Yes, it would be. Yeah.
So
cooking is done just with open fire.
Absolutely. That's the only way we can cook.
Yes.
Otherwise, how can you help yourself with it? So open fire, that's the only way we do our cookings and all this.
Wow. So it's a very different lifestyle to what we would typically consider out here in the West.
Even the PMVs doesn't travel on that road because of the criminal activities and the behaviors of the people. Not like majority of the young people. Or maybe I'll say, majority of the young people. But those, you know, only if those people, the young ones, just cause a lot of problems. So as a matter of fact, the government stopped the bus from traveling here and there because there's many old apps and roadblocks and all this. So they just travel on another route, but not on the area that we are living.
Really, because it's too dangerous?
Yeah.
Mm. So obviously there's people who make a living from the rubbish dump, but there's also other people who make a living from criminal activity?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So was it dangerous growing up there?
Yeah, it was dangerous. But like, as for me, like I live in the dump site and I mean, just near the dump site with those boys and like, I don't know, but like it's like, personally, it's like for me, it's the environment is conducive and it's good for me. But, you know, for other people, like the way they'll judge is more dangerous. But now, like, as I come out and I just look back, it's, yeah, it's very dangerous and it's tough out there. But
sure. But yeah. For you growing up there, because you knew a lot of people and you had a support network.
Absolutely.
It was just part of life and you weren't under any particular threat or danger as such. Wow, incredible. So you, your mum, your dad, your brother and sister, you all grow up there. Now, what changes in your life? I mean, do you attend a school while you guys are living near the rubbish dump?
Yeah, actually, I attend school. It's primary school at one of the schools in Port Moresby. They call it Wigani Primary School. And then I graduated from there to the high school. I failed my grade 10.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I failed my grade 10, but I never give up.
Mm.
You know, it's like there's an acronym for fail. They said, like, first attempt in learning. So
is it acronym for fail? So F-A-I-L, first attempt in learning.
Yeah.
Oh, that's very smart. I like that.
That's where I fail, you know. Failure is, I also call it, like, you know, failure is not when you fall down, but it is rather when you fall down, you do not have the guts to stand up and walk again on the path that God has for you.
Right.
So this is the real failure. Just fail, and then you just give up on everything.
That's failure.
This is failure.
But if you fall and you get up, that is not failure. That's learning.
Not failure. This is
first
learning.
Attempt.
This is first attempt in learning. is where, so I failed my grade 10. Then I tried my best. I was doing the street sales around Port Moresby.
Street sales. And this is from materials and food and products and things that you've got from the rubbish dump.
Absolutely. And then sometimes, like, mostly it's from the materials that, like, I bought it from the Chinese shops. So I have to bring it around the streets in the Port Moresby and sell those phones. And they're not permanent phones or this one, but I have to just try my best as much as possible to make ends meet for my school fee and for my parents and all this. So
you were quite entrepreneurial.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so you were working hard and you also have studying and just a temporary setback with grade 10. But in New Guinea, I assume people have to pay school fees to go to school, or is it free?
You have to pay the school fees.
Right, so your parents paid that for you guys.
But currently it's the government saying it's free education, so people, but still you have to pay some other certain fees, like project fees. And
Now, I know that Operation Food for Life had an impact in your life. And
absolutely.
You're sitting here across from me now with a big Operation Food for Life T-shirt on.
Yeah.
And I wonder if we can start transitioning to that now, because you're living with your parents near the rubbish dump, you're having resources, you're going to school, so you're getting an education. Where does your life start transitioning and you start thinking or dreaming big? Or were you always a big dreamer?
I was always a bigger dreamer, like big dreamer when I was at the dumpsite, right in the dump.
Yes.
While I was in the dump, I always dream big.
Mm.
But then, you know, there comes, you know, I've seen in life where it's, I saw the Operation Food for Life ministry with a PAU van coming in the dump site and then started to feed in us every year. Like,
You
know, consecutively they have been here. And, like, they are not, the Operation Food for Life were not the only people who come in the dump. There were other group of people also. But the difference between the Operation Food for Life and those groups is, you know, there are other groups where they come, but when they come into the dump site, they have to just blow their nose and, you know, spit in front of us. And, like, for us, it's a disgrace for us.
Mm.
You don't come to dump and just spit.
Yeah, so it's offensive. They weren't actually as sensitive to your needs and your own dignity as a person.
Absolutely.
Wow.
So that is where I saw some of the, you know, differences between the Operation Food for Life and the other group. And then they have that Adventist logo on the side of the PAU van that is like the Pacific Adventist vehicle that they always use.
Okay.
So that's where I saw the sign. But back then, like, after some couple of years, I have those some of the Seventh-day Adventist elders at one of the church called the Wigani Seventh-day Adventist Church. They always come and visited me in front of my house with my family and all this. So, you know, sometimes our neighbors always said, Leeboy, you saw those Adventists, they are the only people that killed Jesus on the Sabbath. These are the Sabbath keepers who killed Jesus. And now these people are visiting you. Did you know that these are the, and you are wasting your time worshiping with them. Then, like,
because it was on the Sabbath, they were thinking they were descendants of the Jews, basically, and the Jewish faith. Is that right?
Absolutely.
Ah.
So that, you know, that idea, the preconceived idea, is just, you know, it's stuck in our mind that it's very difficult to just take it out. But then I saw the parallelism between the Operation Food for Life and the elder, the Seventh-day Adventist elder, which is called the Elder David Jeninen and Magia Blen and all those people, Kipsohago, and when they were, like, visiting us, they said, and then, like, I saw that Adventist logo on their set, and I was like, relating, these are the same people Same as the Operation Food for Life that visited us on the dam.
You made the connection between Operation Food for
Absolutely.
Life and these people visiting you.
Absolutely.
So you thought, well, it can't be that bad. Maybe they didn't kill Jesus.
Yeah. So, like, I was trying to, like, relate things here and then. And then, like, there's an occasion where the elder, he asked me. He said, Leeboy, like, he was asking all of us, the children over there. So he said, during the Brent Sabbath School, on a Sabbath day in the morning, around 8 o'clock, he said, you know, do you guys have any aims or dreams in life? Like, you want to share with us, or that I'll pray for all of you? And like, everyone where, you know, they said their dreams and aims. But I said, I wanted to become one of the Seventh-day Adventist church pastor.
And were you a Seventh-day Adventist Christian at this time?
No, I was actually in the Catholic church.
Okay, you were were you raised a Catholic?
I was raised a Catholic, but ever since we moved to the Damside, we haven't been attending church.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. So, but you believed in God, but you just weren't church people.
Absolutely. All the people in Papua New Guinea believe in God. I think it's more than 95, even 98.
I have heard that. That is remarkable.
All of them are Christians, yeah.
Yeah. Wow. So you're Catholic. You have people visiting you. They're not connected directly with Operation Food for Life. The elders, they were just from the church.
They were not connected.
But in your mind, you connect the logo from the elders from that church with Operation Food for Life.
Absolutely, that's what I did.
Yeah. So how old were you the first time you got exposed to the work of Operation Food for Life?
Actually, I was about 10.
Okay.
About 10 and 11 years old. That's what's.
So you remember the first time you saw this van coming in and the people doing it? But you probably at that time thought, this is just one of many people who come in. They're probably going to spit.
But
these people are different.
Absolutely.
They show respect.
The way they hug us and, you know, shake our hands, and it makes us like we feel comfortable. Not only they feed us with the food, but they only show sympathy. Not only sympathy, but it's empathy that they show to us. It's like we feel that, you know, they are part of us.
Mm. Yeah. So it's a genuine concern and care for you as a person. Oh, praise the Lord. So what happens next? You're studying with the people. They've asked you this question now. What do you want to do one day? And you have an ambition. You say you want to become a pastor.
Yeah, absolutely.
But you're still not part of that denomination. You're in another denomination.
I wasn't. When they know that, like, I wanted to become a Seventh-day Adventist pastor, that elder, he actually, you know, he was, like, he had that interest in me.
Mm.
So they started to sponsor me while I was doing my grade 4. And then up till grade 8, I graduate. Grade 9 and grade 10, I failed my grade 10.
Yes.
But they didn't give up on me. They still support me.
So they saw promise in you because they saw the ambition in you that the Lord had placed in your heart. Yes.
So while I was failing my grade 10, I was doing the street sales on the road. Mm. And then I have some, my mother, she gave me some of the money that she make, and like during, like, she recycled those products at the dump site. She have another 600 kina, which is approximately, it's $300. She gave it to me to do those street sales and then to find another school again and continue my grade 11 or year 11 and year 12.
Mm.
So that is where.
So you had good support from your mom and dad as well?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You know, even though, like, we live in a downside where we don't have money and all these ones, but they never gave up on me. They were persistent and, you know.
Yeah.
Supporting me all the time.
Well, praise God. Look, what I want to do is I just actually want to share Operation Food for Life's contact details. And if you're watching on Facebook, we are streaming this live on Facebook at the moment. We do have those contact details on the information that is part of the video there. But you can write to them if you'd like at P.O. Box 519 Cherrybrook, and that's in New South Wales. And the postcode is 2126. 2126. And that is in New South Wales, Australia. Or you can even make contact with them on the phone if you want to. In Australia, code is 61 or plus 61 from international. And the area code is 2. Then it's 9875-1406. Now, you can also find the information on their website, which is OFFL. So that stands for Operation Food for Life, OFFL.org.au. So OFFL.org.au. You can even email them at info@OFFL.org.au. And we are just about to take a break here after we've finished our first half, and we'll be right back after these messages. Stay tuned.
One of the great promises of the Bible is the promise of the resurrection. The Bible says that when Jesus comes back to this earth, the dead in Christ shall rise. Now, just recently, a man in Spain was declared dead. He was prepared for an autopsy. Marks were drawn on his body to guide the doctor performing the autopsy. So this was really about to happen. When the man began snoring on the autopsy table. So how? Well, it's not always easy to be certain someone is dead, apparently. And this sort of thing has happened before. But once a person is really dead, you're not bringing them back. Unless, here's 1 Thessalonians 4:16. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Death is sad, but it isn't final. There's a resurrection day coming. Good news. I'm John Bradshaw for It Is Written. Let's live today by every word.
Dear listener, welcome back. You are listening to By the Word of Their Testimony, and my special guest in the studio all the way from Papua New Guinea is Pastor Leeboy Tobias. Leeboy, welcome. It's good to have you. We've heard the first half just about your life and how you were an ambitious young man, but you were living in an area where people typically would think there would be not a lot of opportunity for someone to progress and grow and develop.
Absolutely.
You were living near a rubbish dump, and the rubbish dump was a source of resource for you, so where you could recycle, you could sell food from it and so forth. But at the same time, you were also working on your education. Your parents wanted you to go to school, and you also found some people who saw ambition in you and saw promise in you and then decided to sponsor you going through school. So perhaps we can pick up the story from there. You were now starting to look at, you know, furthering your education.
While I was there at the dump site, like as soon as I graduated from my grade 12, you know, I failed my grade 10, and then I was doing those street sales and all this one. And then I continue again for my grade 11 when there's a school that is opening, and they were looking for a new grade 11 and 12, so I joined the school, which is...
So how did you juggle, I guess, your responsibilities between having to do school and then also having to run a business on the side, you know? Was that difficult, or just what got the priorities?
I think I put my priorities on the sales instead of the education.
Right.
Yeah. So like after school, around 3 p.m., I always go home, get the stuff that I need to do those street sales, and then I sell on the street.
Mm.
So it's always like this. Like those street sales, it's not just because I failed my grade 10, and I was selling ever since I was in grade 6 and grade 7.
Oh, really?
In the primary school.
This was part of who you were. So you were an industrious young man even from a young age.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So this is where, so from there I continued my grade 11 and grade 12, and then I was filling the school leaver form to continue my grade 12. So a pastor, which is called Pastor Bunny Jack.
Okay.
He passed away already. He was the youth director for the Central Papua Conference, Seventh-day Adventist Church in Port Moresby.
Hmm.
He just passed away two years ago. So he was preaching on a Sabbath, and he talked about life, and he was talking about Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verses 1 and 13 and 14, and he said, like, everything is vanity. And then, like, I was recalling back to, wow, true, everything is vanity without God, and
yes,
God needs
yes.
to be. So then it reminds me back of the plan, the ambition, like the aim that I have, the goals. So I said, like, I applied to study theology at Sonoma Adventist College in East New Britain. So that is where I continue my education to my college.
So when you got busy in your life for a while there, you'd lost sight of some of the ambitions that you had as a young person?
Absolutely.
And then this sermon is one that brings it back to mind and remember, but this is where I want to head.
Absolutely. I was good at maths and science, and this one, I wasn't good at English and all this, so I was thinking something around maths and science, but when the pastor was preaching on a Sabbath, he just reminded me back to the plan that I have, and I was said, so I choose to go to Sonoma. So,
however, so you're attending a Seventh-day Adventist church now, so you've become a Seventh-day Adventist?
Absolutely.
Okay.
I was baptized in 2012 when Pastor John Carter, he was conducting a meeting in Papua New Guinea. 2012.
Wow.
So there are thousands of us, a lot of us we baptized, about approximately more than 3,000 people baptized.
Baptized, and you were one of those 3,000?
I am one of those 3,000 people.
Mm.
So straight after I baptized, I applied to study theology at Sonoma Adventist College.
Okay.
So I went to Sonoma Adventist College, very tough out there, especially to look for school fees and all these ones, but I was grateful for the Waigani Seventh-day Adventist Church, which is, we are the branch church. So they were supporting me in terms of funding, like the elders that visited me, Elder David Jeninen and his son, Desmond Jeninen, who is now blessed by God and he's the youngest CEO in Papua New Guinea, National Bank.
He's the CEO of the National Bank of Papua New Guinea.
Absolutely.
And these were the people
National
who were
Development
studying
Bank.
Okay, well, so these are smart, intelligent people. They must have seen some promise in you to actually
Probably,
and sponsor you and look after you.
So that person and his father, they supported me and sponsored me in my education. So I continue my education to the college where, you know, when it comes to the final year, it was very tough. Very tough that the school have to just chase us away from the school because we don't have funding. So me and six other theology students, they just chase us out of the school. About approximately it's 5-6 kilometers away from the school. So we have to just, you know, make our house from the from the kunai grass that we just cut along the bushes, and we have to get all those timbers from logs from different area, and we just put together, and it's the house that we built is just 5 meters, 7 meters long, and then another 3 or 4 meters wide. So we have to just, you know, cross our legs against each other and sleep, because if we close our legs and sleep, it's, we are going to bump ourselves. So we have to just split, like open our legs and then intersect to each other, and then we have to sleep. So it makes it easier for us to sleep. And it was very tough out there, no water, not even power, no, we don't have any food to.
So, and there's no rubbish dump nearby to provide any resources either.
So like what we usually do is we have a small list that we paste on the wall that is written like different boy, like seven of us, we have different schedule where, but the main staple food was tapioca and coconut.
Right.
So different boy has a different schedule. So me, I said, please don't change my schedule. Just put it on the coconut only.
Okay.
So every day when the students went out for their lunch, the college student, I have to go in the bush and then look for coconut, husk them, and then pack it in the bag to just walk another 6 kilometers back to home. And those boys, they like one after the other, they have to, you know, the other day, they have their schedule. So when it reached 5 o'clock in the evening, every boys and the girls always go and have their lunch, the college students, the boarding students. So we don't have, you know, we don't have access to those food. So
Because you've got no funding anymore. Yeah.
So all the best, like best tapioca that they always get from the garden, they bring it to the mess. But some of the leftover ones that they don't need it and they just throw it, we have to pack it into a 10 kg bag or a 20 kg bag and then lift it from there and walk another 6 kilometers down to our house.
Wow.
Just to cook this food and
carrying 20 kg bag for 6 kilometers, that's you'll be very fit if you do that a few times.
Wow.
It'll wear you out.
Absolutely.
Okay, so although you guys are living in difficult circumstances, you still have structure to your life. You still have schedules and people providing for each other, so you can actually live in a functional community, even if it's only six people.
Absolutely. So that is where, you know, it's very tough out there. But however, by God's grace, one of the elder at Waigani Seventh-day Adventist Church has just passed away, late Dr. Tenda, with the help of the Seventh-day Adventist Church at Nautana. And Nautana is where I lived, just beside the dumpsite, and the Waigani Adventist Church, where they gather together, you know, they collect some free will offering, and then they support me in my education. So that's where me and some of the boys, too, that we just graduated from in 2015.
So you're not a boarding student, you live in your own accommodation, which you've made, but you get enough funding to at least attend school and then graduate.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, praise the Lord that happened, because obviously there's progress there. So what happened subsequent to that? Because I know we're getting to a step where Operation Food for Life enters your life again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So from there, I received a call from the Central Papua Conference of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Port Moresby to serve as one of the intent minister. So I was called to serve in one of the villages, which is called Babiko, which is about some of the, like 3 to 4 hours drive away from Port Moresby to Iritano Highway. So that was in 2016. I served over there for about 2 months, just only 3 months, and my father passed away.
Oh, sorry to hear that.
So it was run over by a vehicle from a pedestrian crossing. And then we couldn't call the person who is responsible for what happened. So, however, you know, again, the Adventist Church, Waigani Seventh-day Adventist Church, they were helping me out. And then we buried my father. And from there, I was accepted to Pacific Adventist University. And that is where I came into contact with the Operation Food for Life again. Yeah, so I was accepted into Pacific Adventist University, and I thought, like, well, it's university, and then it's just close to my house, so life would be much more easier.
Yes.
Because East New Britain from Sonoma Adventist College is just hours flight away from where I was.
Okay.
But this one is just close to my house, so I was expecting something like, I'm going to relax when it comes to school fee and all this one, but it was very tough out there.
Really?
Yeah, very, very tough. Living at a dump site and traveling here and there again to school.
Mm.
Yeah, it's, wow.
So, yeah, so more demanding than you expected. You thought it was going to be easier,
absolutely,
but it actually turned out a little bit different to that. And how do you get funding for education? I mean, because, I mean, you got to pay for it. It's not free.
Yeah. So the school fee is, it's 8,100 kina.
Okay.
And in Australian dollars, maybe it's $3,600 or
$700. Well, that's a fair bit of money.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I couldn't afford that money because my father just passed away and I was just working about 6 months in the conference.
Mm.
And my father passed away. I have to just pay for all the, like, you know, burial and all these services.
Sure.
With the help of the church. And then I have to pay for my school fee again. Mm. I was fortunate enough that on my acceptance letter, the Pacific Adventist University is supposed to write 29th of February, the school will start.
Mm.
But they write 29th of March. So I just send this letter to the conference and I withdraw from the work to continue study. And then instead of paying me and stop paying me around 29th of March, they just overpaid me till 29th of May. Because of the letter that PAU sent, which is wrong. But I was blessed because that extra school fee, just extra payment just went right into my school fee. So I have to just pay the 25% of the first semester.
Mm.
And with the help of one of my class girls, which her name is Lenani Matthew, she's helped me in some of the, I don't know, like, she's my class girl. She's also facing a school fee problem, but by God's grace, she supported me. She said, Leeboy, She was asking me during the day, like, she said, Leeboy, what happened? Like, are you going to come to school? I said, well, I am still struggling. And then she said, how may I help you? And I said, no, I need some money.
Mm.
And it's about this. And I know that she is not going to pay, but I need her prayers. And I asked her to pray, but she said,
yes,
look, I'm going to help you with something, at least a little. And I thought she is going to just give me half of it or just a little, but she just gave me exactly what I need.
Well, praise the Lord. So not only was she praying for you, she was an answer to prayer as well.
Absolutely.
Wow.
And from there, I continue my education, but I always receive, you know, emails from the Pacific Adventist University here and there. They said, Leeboy, you need to pay your 75% outstanding.
Yes.
And then I said, I'm going to pay. And then second semester was there. They asked me, I said, I'm going to pray. I promise. Like, I was praying and praying. I didn't let my mother know all these years because I don't want her to suffer pain that I'm feeling.
Yes.
She might, like, you know, high blood pressure or heart attack. And so I was just keeping it myself. Even I didn't let my family know because, you know, they are not Adventist and they don't support me when it comes to, because it's, I am the only Adventist and they always, you know,
yes,
go against me and all this. So, so by the grace of God.
So you're there now studying and pretty much living by faith because you don't know where the money's going to come from.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, when the conference president and all these people, they ask me, Leeboy, how are you going to pay your school fee? I said, listen, I have 10 times the amount I needed for the school fee.
You said that?
I said that to all the president and I said, like, I have this money. All you have to do is just release me for study and then my school fee will be provided. Inside my brain, I know that God is going to provide because he has provided many things
for people.
So that
was a statement of faith on your part.
Absolutely.
Because you feel like God had called you to ministry and his biddings, you know, are enablings. what he calls you to do, he equips you to do. And you knew that money is part of the equipping that the Lord would provide.
That's absolutely. Yeah. So from there, it's like I was, it was during my graduation and it comes to the end of the year. And that same girl, the same woman, Lenali Matthew, paid for my, she helped me for my school fee.
Yeah.
She was the one who paid for my graduation gown also. And I was like, wow, why did you do that? Like,
yes.
It's amazing.
So what are you graduating from at the moment? So what's the program that you're doing, the course?
I was doing Bachelor of Arts in Theology. I was wanted to become the pastor.
Okay,
yeah.
Right.
So it was during the end of the graduation. It was just close to the graduation where the night before graduation, it was the Sabbath night.
Mm.
And then, like, people were asking constantly, like, they were pestering me, like, when are you going to graduate? When are you going to graduate? I said, listen, God is going to email me tonight in my email and tell me go and graduate tomorrow in the morning.
Yes.
It was amazing, and I couldn't believe that. Just 10 o'clock in the night, 9 o'clock in the night, I was just opening my email, and I was expecting something, but I've seen nothing. So as soon as I went to log out, I saw a new email coming in. When I checked the new email, I saw that it was the Dean of Theology at Pacific Adventist University, Elizabeth Simonsen, a Tongan lady,
yes.
Dr. Elizabeth Simonsen. She emailed me and said, Leeboy, I paid your school fee in full.
The dean paid your school fee?
Absolutely. Maybe there are some funding out there where she has those funding. So she paid my school fee in full.
I was praise like, the Lord for
I
that.
Was amazing,
yeah.
And I was shocked. Even the clothes that I wore for the graduation, the church members, they bought it for me. Yeah, one of the church members, his name is Basha Robert, and the other one is the Kayo family or the Bulu family.
Yes.
Yeah, Buluwe family. It was some of the Engans and, you know, coastal people where they sponsored me. So they pay for my graduation gown. And, you know, it's like, it was amazing. Those church members helping me out. And, you know, another Wabek Engen fellow up in the islands, his name is Denny. He also paid for my clothes and all this one. And I was like, God, you are just bringing everyone into my life where...
Yes.
It's...
Well, you know, you just listening to your story, I'm impressed by the fact that you've been industrious from a young age. You weren't a person that was shy of work. You would work, you would study. Now you're studying, but you don't know where the means are going to come from. If you had an opportunity, you would have tried to fund it yourself, but there's no other way. So now you realize, I've got to live by faith. The Lord has called me to this. He ultimately will provide, and the Lord blesses you with the means.
Yeah.
But right on the last minute, so he's testing your faith.
Absolutely. That is why, like, you know, when God said in First Luke chapter 1, verses 37, nothing is impossible, all things are possible, it is.
Yes.
That's in Philippians 3, verses 14 also. Philippians 4:13, that's what God said. All things are possible through Christ who strengthens me, and I believe in that. And as for me personally, I won't give up. And now I am trying to pursue my studies for my master's.
Are you studying your master's now?
Actually, yeah. I applied to continue. Okay. Yeah.
So you're not just going to stop there with the Bachelor of Arts in Theology.
Okay. I'm heading towards my master's at Andrews University. I already applied and just waiting for that. I wanted even to do my doctoral degree at Andrews University, so I won't give up. So that is where I came into contact with the Operation Food for Life when I met them at the Pacific Adventist University.
Oh, really? Now, I know that we've called this program From Poverty to Praise.
Yeah.
And God is transforming your life. I mean, it's remarkable. So, tell me about the connection. How do we get to Operation Food for Life? How do they step back into your life again? So, what happens?
I was at Pacific Adventist University while I was doing a presentation, a 2-minute presentation that they asked me during a Friday evening Wespa. And then someone in the Pacific Adventist University, the registrar, Pele Halu, she was one of the volunteers who helped the Operation Food for Life. That time she was the CNA husband. They were the PNG director for the Operation Food for Life. Now currently it's Philip and Maureen Vaki.
Okay.
But back then it was them. So she saw me doing that presentation in the dump site while I was at the dump, one of the pictures. So she talked to the Operation Food for Life director. Currently it's the Dennis Perry. So
yes.
When Dennis Perry was in Papua New Guinea at Pacific Adventist University at that time, it was last year. And then she talked to him, and Dennis Perry emailed me and he said, can we just meet and then talk it over? And so when I came into contact with them and I talked with Dennis was showing me some of the pictures at the dam site. And he said, did you know those people? I said, these are the people that I've been living with for all my life.
And is that right?
So that is where the connection, you know, it's...
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, funny enough, you should mention Dennis Perry's name, because I know Dennis from way back. Back in 1989, I was new in Auckland, New Zealand. I'd just come back from Africa. And Dennis was the new marketing manager for Sanitarium Health and Wellbeing in New Zealand. And I was a green, brand new sales rep. They were training me to be a sales rep, and I ended up working for Dennis back then. And it's interesting that now, after all these years, our connection has been reacquainted with Operation Food for Life and him bringing you here so you can share your testimony today.
This man is not retired, he's refired.
Refired.
Absolutely. And, you know, he has a lot of testimony that his mess has become his message. And now, me too personally, it's like my mess is my message.
Your mess is your message. Praise the Lord. I love that because that's what testimonies are. It's the Lord changing people's lives and taking their mess and turning it into a message. I love that. That sounds like something that you would have heard from Dennis.
Yeah.
Yes.
Actually, Dennis Perry always said, like, you know, aspire to inspire before you expire. So before you expire, he has to aspire to inspire people first.
Aspire to inspire before you expire.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Yeah, that's right. And I also, one that I remember even as a sales rep, because he'd come in and he'll motivate us, you know, to go and sell and do well. And he always said that, you know, if anything seems impossible, just remember it's him possible.
Yeah.
That's another one that he's told us about.
It's I am P-O-O, like P-O-S-S-I-B-L-E. I am possible. It's impossible to, and it's, you know, this is great. I mean,
yeah, wonderful. Well, yeah. You're in contact with a good man. That will be an encouragement to you as well. But you know, you obviously have some great aspirations yourself.
Yeah.
So these people from Operation Food for Life get in touch with you, and then there's a level of support provided to
Absolutely.
You.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So when I get in touch with them, I involve with them while I was studying. I involve with them going out to new schools that they were building currently.
Mm.
It's about 5 hours drive, and it's very tough out there to go to that school. You know, people doesn't have that better education, and they were struggling for better education. And the Operation Food for Life Ministry just travel out there to help those people at Philip and Maureen Vakis Village, and they help other people like in the city of Port Moresby in. Harima, they were helping those people to, you know, especially the school and all this. And then they were looking after 30 boys and girls. Orphanages were like, back, like their history is like, you know, some of them were raped and some of them were chased, like, you know, they were chased out by their parents. Some of them are homeless and they come with different, but Operation
different
Food
needs.
For Life. Yeah, different needs and different lifestyle, but Operation Food for Life cannot turn anyone away. They just get everyone. And now they have 30 boys and girls living with them currently in an house, which is they call the sanctuary.
The sanctuary?
Yeah.
Operation Food for Life Sanctuary.
Operation Food for Life Sanctuary.
Praise the Lord.
So
it started with just feeding those who were in need. And from there, the operations have actually developed now that they actually have a home, even for the homeless and for those who have suffered severe trauma and deprivation in their life.
I tell you the truth. Even those kids, they have a better house than other Papua New Guineans.
Is that right?
Those small, you know, the boys and the girls, they don't only go to the prison, but like Operation Food for Life go and visit prisoners. They build schools. They look after the people. The boys are the small boys, like the children, as early as 6 months up to 18, 19 years old boys, like children. And then they even go to the hospital doing hospital visitation and go to some of the disadvantaged, like homes where, you know, they're looking after those disadvantaged children. So they have done a marvelous work in Papua New Guinea. Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Now, I'm curious. You only take a two-minute presentation at this Vespers program. Are you the only one that was presenting that day, or
no,
are there some other people?
There are other people also doing their presentation.
So why do they select you out of all the people? Was it your presentation that impressed them? I'm just a curious question. I mean,
I believe when we look at those things, it's not about us.
Okay.
It's about God. And God is in control.
God is in control. So absolutely, this was God's purpose for your life at the time. Yeah, no, praise God. So what are the plans moving forwards? Because you're obviously a pastor, but you're also involved in Operation Food for Life. So how do these two intersect? How does that work together?
Now I am, you know, working with the Operation Food for Life, and we were trying to reach out the needies in Papua New Guinea as much as we can.
Yes.
With little that we have,
but
with the heart that God has given us to reach out to the people. So we were, you know, trying our best as much as possible to reach out to other nearest villages that we can, you know, give them clothes and food and anything that, you know, we have within our means to
share
with
them. Yeah, that's right. So if people want to get involved and support Operation Food for Life, I've put their contact details on our Facebook page, and we also have the video, the live stream of our recording at the moment. Of course, we're going to edit this program, and it does go to air, and then it'll be available on demand as well from our website. But if you want to get involved with Operation Food for Life, their website is www.OFFL. So the OFFL stands for Operation Food for Life, .org.au, and you can get all their contact details there. But I'll also share their phone number with you now. So it's country code 61, and the area code is 2. Then the phone number is 9875-1406. And you can send an email as well, which is info@OFFL.org.au. So my special guest in the studio today here is Pastor Leeboy Tobias, and he is a pastor at the church. Perhaps you can just mention the name of the church where you're currently pastoring.
The church is Dubona Teboa Seventh-day Adventist Church in Rigo District, Central Popo Conference of the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Okay. And also, he's also involved with Operation Food for Life because of the contact. He remembered them from a young age, and it was the logo of these people that were helping the people at the rubbish dump and the respect that these people were showing. And then later, some people came to study with him. And although there was some level of skepticism, there was some level of prejudice, you remembered the logo. It was the same logo that the Operation Food for Life people had. You were able to bridge that skepticism, and you were able now to spend time and study and pray. And when people asked you what you wanted to do, and you said you believe God has called you to be a pastor in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, you were able to get sponsorship. And you've pretty much lived by faith. And if people want to get involved, because you guys are still living by faith, because this is a faith-based ministry, isn't it?
Absolutely. I mean,
there's not the way that you operate is through people who believe in what you do, who may not be able to travel themselves, who may not be able to be their hands right there at the rubbish dump and helping the needy, but they can help with their financial means and, of course, also with their prayers.
Mm. Yeah.
So we've got a couple of minutes left. What else can you share about what you guys do? And then we'll share our contact details in case people have missed it on the program today.
I have a good news that for all this work and the involvement of the Operation Food for Life, the Rainbow Seventh-day Adventist Church in Port Moresby has established a branch church with the leadership of Elder Guaibo at the dam site. And now they have a Seventh-day Adventist church established over there. And if there is anything that I would like to say,
yes,
it would be that I just wish that those people living at the campsite, my people, the boys and girls, because ever since back then, they don't have that opportunity to study, to go for further education.
Yes.
Nor do they study in the elementary or the primary school.
Mm.
So I just wish that the Operation Food for Life ministry would establish a school, maybe a primary or elementary school, so that it would break the curse of the boys and the girls that live on the garbage dump.
So you are an exception. Not everybody went to school, the primary school and high school.
Right now, currently, I'm speaking with you. I don't think anyone
who lives on the rubbish dump that goes to school.
Yeah. Like, they go to school, but they didn't continue further education. They just, when they dropped out, they just said, it is enough. We have everything we need.
Mm.
Yeah.
So the greatest need at the moment is actually to get a school going, to start off with a primary school, or to be able to go primary school and high school. You'd like to do both if you can. Okay.
Only a couple of students rest right now, maybe two or three just come out and they, you know, continuing to college and then they just go back and like this, or even the secondary school, but not much of them, many of them.
Literacy school.
Great, thank you. We've got Dennis Perry in the studio with us there. It's a literacy school. Okay, so it's important to be able to read and write, and also be able to, I guess, get into some maths as well. Right. Okay, so that's the biggest need. So the Lord has placed this burden on your heart, and obviously it's the burden of Operation Food for Life as well.
Yeah, for the Operation Food for Life.
This is the burden of Operation Food for Life. So if there is something that you want for your people, this is it. You want them to get an education.
Absolutely. Mm. For a literacy school to be established in the garbage site. The dump.
Okay. Praise the Lord. Well, dear listener, you are listening to By the Word of Their Testimony, and my special guest is Pastor Leeboy Tobias from Papua New Guinea, who's just been sharing his life journey and his testimony, and also the work of Operation Food for Life, which he's involved in. We're just going to give you our contact details now. Stay tuned, and we'll be right back after these messages.
Thank you for joining us on By the Word of Their Testimony. If you would like more information about today's program, or if you have any questions, please contact 3ABN Australia Radio by phoning 02-4973-3456. Or you can send an email to radio@3abnaustralia.org.au. You can also contact us on our 3ABN Australia Radio Facebook page. We look forward to hearing from you.
Dear listener, welcome back. You are listening to By the Word of Their Testimony, and we've got Pastor Leeboy Tobias in the studio sharing his testimony and also the work of Operation Food for Life. Now, we only have about 2 minutes left on this program, so I'm just going to hand it over to you to share an encouragement to our listeners out there.
Thank you very much. If there is anything that I would like to say, I'd like to let you know, the listeners, that nothing is impossible to God.
Mm.
So when you fall down, don't give up. Stand up and then walk again on the path that God has for you. Yes. Failure is, again, first attempt in learning. It is not when you fall down, but it is when you fall down and you do not have the guts to stand up and walk again.
Mm.
And suppose you want Blaman law. I just translated it into talk pisin. If you're Papua New Guinea listeners listening right now, suppose you want Blaman or Mary, where you think of some life walk long, trauma or plant something, you know, good long life, blue, now you think of some, you bahad lo survive, na live. Me like talking you straight or some, you gaman. Lob long nature, I'm talking. When I'm something, you give him lo life, and by give him come again lo you. Also, now you know, can get on negative thinking in your life, blue. Suppose you been got on negative thinking stuff. Listeners, me like talking you now, please no can get on negative thinking. Got strong blood thinking. God am talk us me got plan no life blow you, plan where by me give him you, by you live him good plan, a nice plan, a sweet plan life. Now you no plan lo bagrap him life blow you. Devil come lo still kill na destroy him life blow you.
Mm-hmm.
Friends, I am good. Papa God and me got big plan no life blow you. Once you put down lo one him up, you stop long him, no can give up. Kirap na walk about again. Ask him God, depend lo God. All things are possible through Christ who strengthens us. All get us something. Impossible true on Jesus Christ. In all our own strength, blow me blah. Let him God control him life, blow you. Now, by you looking, one mass word, blow him back come up. Now, result, blow him back come up, life, blow you. Thank you very much.
Amen. You know, funny enough, I don't speak pidgin, but I could understand a few things here and there, and I can say praise the Lord and amen. So, thank you very much, Pastor Leeboy Tobias, for sharing with us, even in pidgin. And for our listeners, and we've got many supporters from Facebook, from Papua New Guinea, who would have appreciated your messages of encouragement to them. Dear listener, thank you for joining us today on By the Word of Their Testimony. We look forward to catching up with you next time. Until then, God bless.
You've been listening to a production of 3ABN Australia Radio.